Hello, friends. This is Pastor David Lankford coming to you again today. I'm with my dear friend Steve Quayle. We're in his studio recording, and we hope that what we have been sharing with you in the last few segments have been edifying to you and strengthening you. And to be honest with you, we've tried to be transparent and share a little bit of our personal testimonies. They're not for the purpose of glorifying our sins of the past, but to let you know that we certainly understand temptation. We understand trial. We understand times of loneliness, feeling like one might be ostracized or alienated from people, even from God for that matter. But that's just the trick of the enemy, because Jesus promised us he would never leave us, he would never forsake us, but he would be with us always, amen, even unto the end. So I want to encourage you, go back sometimes and watch these programs. You'll pick up something that you missed the first time, and it will be something that will be significant to your spiritual life and your walk with Christ.
David, let's talk about the rapture and what that has done in the way of blocking a powerful witness for Jesus. Because in essence, the rapture is still a point of contention. Most people think they don't have to interact with civilization, society, or do anything, because basically, any minute now, Jesus is going to come back. Now, I believe in the second coming. You believe in the second coming. But you are a pastor of the Church of God, and your royal position, or their royal position, not yours, is you must believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. Share your story, because this is important to get on tape. Again, because it was God after fasting that showed you what the story was. Please, I won't interrupt you.
Back in 1994, again, I had become hungry and thirsty for God, as we spoke about previously. And I made a statement from the pulpit, not knowing how deeply I was committing myself. And I made the statement Sunday morning, there's about 300 people sitting there, and I said, I am not going to eat a bite of food till God moves in my life in the manner and the capacity that I feel like he needs to move. I didn't know what I was missing. I knew there was something wrong. I knew I wasn't getting something right, doctrinally correct, but I didn't know what it was. And so I started a fast, and I didn't know that fast would lead me into a 40-day fast. It was on the 21st day of my fast. I was standing in the kitchen drinking some water when the Spirit of God spoke to my heart, and he said, on the 35th day of your fast, I'm going to move on you like I've never moved on you before in your life. And I walked around the kitchen to the pantry, and I looked at the calendar, and the 35th day would have been on a Sunday. And so I was anticipating a great move of God, but I wasn't anticipating God to extend my fast like that, because I felt like I'd have my answer before that. Needless to say, we went to church that Sunday morning. We had a great service. Nothing happened to what I thought should have happened. And we were going back home from church. I told my wife, she was sitting in the front seat. I looked at her and said, I miss God. She said, what do you mean? I said, well, God told me he was going to move on me in a way I'd never had him move before. And so I've missed him. And, you know, this is why you need to appreciate your wife, guys, because they can sometimes speak one simple word and turn your world around. She said, we still have tonight service, and so don't give up on God. And so I really didn't take that to heart, but needless to say, we got back to church that night, and the service was going typically as a normal Sunday night service would go. And I just walked to the pulpit when it was time for me to preach. I just had a little brown New Testament Bible, and I laid it on the pulpit, and I said, I don't want to do anything tonight but just worship God. And people were looking at me kind of, you know, cockeyed, you might say. And three other girls were still singing very softly on the mic, and I just dismissed them. I said, you can go sit down. I don't want any singing. And Sister Coffee was still playing the piano very softly under my voice. And I said, you know, Sister Coffee, I said, you can go sit down. I don't even want to hear any music. And it's as quiet as a funeral parlor. I mean, it's just deathly quiet. And all of a sudden, this bluish cloud began to roll into the sanctuary, just like billowing. And the power of God came in there, Steve, so unbelievably. It struck me and threw me back on my back. And I was under such the presence of God. I said, God, if you do not take this off of me, you're going to kill me. Now, I had never been in that dimension spiritually, but I felt like his presence was sucking the life out of my body. I mean, it was the most phenomenal thing I'd ever felt. And I felt I was going to die. I understood John the Revelator and Daniel at that point in time. Mm-hmm. You feel like you're going to die, because that was the glory. I had never been in that dimension. And Henry's got a powerful testimony about the church he was at. They were singing, "Send down the glory." And God said, "If I send the glory, I'll kill half the people in this church." And so you can shout, preach, sing music under the anointing, but the glory is the doxa. It's the very presence of God himself, and it will kill you. And it was at that point I had a vision of the Old Testament tabernacle, and what God showed me, anywhere God himself goes, he sends an entourage of angels, and they prepare a way of holiness for him. Isaiah 35, 8 says, "And the highway shall be there, and a way of holiness, and the unclean shall not pass over it." What I began to realize, God was cleaning me up to take me into this dimension, because it would have killed me, Steve. I didn't know that at the point in time, but this prayer and fasting was purging me so that the glory could come and he could reveal these things to me. And I won't go through all of it, but he showed me the Old Testament tabernacle and how the glory of God, just like a shaft, would come down on the mercy seat behind the veil in the Holy of Holies. And he showed me that. Service concluded, and I still wasn't happy. Even though I had that august experience, I just wasn't happy. And I was down 2 weeks later praying again. I finished the 40 days. That was the 35th day. I broke the fast on the 40th day. I was still praying, and I remember exactly where I was. I was on my knees praying, and the Lord spoke. I said to the Lord, I said, "I still don't know what I need to know." And I said, "I'll go on another 40-day fast. I'm going to find out what I need to know." And the Spirit spoke to my heart, said, "Don't fast. Pray. I want you to spend 3 hours a day praying." And I'm like, 3 hours a day? I got things to do. You know. So I started 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour noon, lunch, and then another hour at night. After 6 more months now of praying like this, I walk in the house one day. I'd been walking and praying in front of my house when I lived in Stanley. Yep. I walked in the living room, and the Spirit said, "Sit down. You're ready." And God opened up 1 Peter 1:7 about the coming of the Lord, that your faith might be found worthy of honor and praise and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. And the Lord said, that there's only one second coming. There's not two. And Peter is telling that to us. He's coming in his glory.
But again, remember, people need to understand, he is a Church of God pastor, and their position is there's a pre-tribulation rapture, which would be the first coming, and then Jesus' second coming follows that.
Exactly. So from that point onward, I walked under an anointing for 2 years. Every Bible verse I read was an illumination. I mean, I had a pretty decent understanding of the Scriptures, but now it was like a sunburst. My mind exploded. I could see things I had never seen before. It was because of the anointing of the Holy Ghost. But to condense this quickly, God showed me that there was no pre-tribulation rapture. And so the way I began to understand that was, where did we get this idea at? Where did this come from? And of course, I did all my study, you know, with the Plymouth Brethren and Margaret
McDonald
and the Plymouth Brethren.
Darby and
yeah.
Schofield.
And it's all hogwash, because every doctrine must be based on Bible Scripture. And when you try to find two second comings of Christ in the New Testament, or in the Old Testament for that fact, you only find him coming once as a child in a manger and the second time on a great white stallion. There is nowhere in the Scriptures we see a pre-tribulation rapture. It just does not exist. I'll give you a scripture. Hebrews 9:28. "Unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." Now, exegete that verse. Is that a pre-tribulation coming or second advent coming? You can't answer it. I already know. But I know the truth. It is solely a second advent coming. And I taught the 24th chapter of Matthew. And to show you how well I exegeted that chapter, the word "and" is used 52 times in that one chapter. 52 times, the continual.
David, I wouldn't have known that unless you told me that.
My point is the continuation, the conjunction.
Sure.
It never ceases.
It's an ongoing thing.
All right. So when you read Matthew 24, do you ever see a rapture? No. See, because there is not one. The Bible is clear. Jesus himself said in Matthew 24, 29, "Immediately after the tribulation of those days, then shall appear the sign of the coming of the Son of Man." I was told there's a 7-year tribulation period. Well, I start looking for that.
Yep.
Well, you can't find that. Now, where all that came from was Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, which says, "He shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week." They built this whole false doctrine, this whole narrative is built on that one verse. Now, find me another verse of 7 years that we can make doctrine. Well, you can't, because every verse alludes to a 3 1/2 year period, 42 month period, or 1260 day period. All those fundamentally are just 3 1/2 years. You'll find that in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 12. You'll find it in Revelation chapter 11. The two witnesses prophesy 42 months. Revelation 12 and 6, times and dividing of times. And then 1260 days in Revelation 12 and 14. And then in Revelation 13, 5, you have the term 42 months. So it's always 3 1/2 years. Why? This was the part of the revelation. Jesus got the first half of Daniel's 70th week. Then we went into the church age, the church dispensation. Now what we're waiting for is for the last 42 months to click in. When does the 42 months start? At the revelation of the Antichrist. When he is revealed, the clock starts. Then shall be great tribulation. Matthew 24, 15. When you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, and in most Bibles of having parentheses, whosoever readeth, let him understand. Jesus is quoting Daniel 9, and then that parentheses is significant because it takes spiritual understanding. Luke 24, 45. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. So I started looking for the marriage supper of the Lamb in heaven for 7 years. It's not there. I started looking for all of these things I was taught. I was taught wrong. You have been taught wrong, regretfully. And here's what keeps us from coming to the truth. You ready for this? Your pride. Because you can't admit you're wrong. Now, here's what I did after the 40-day fast and the revelation. I went to the pulpit on Sunday morning and I said, "Hey, I was wrong." Boy, what freedom, Steve, that gave me. What liberty, because it is hard for me sometimes to say I'm wrong. Being honest here.
Well, I've known you for 23 years, and I can't think of once until I talk to your wife.
Yeah, she tells you how wrong I'm all the time. Yeah. But that gave me the liberty to stand up publicly and say I was wrong. That's when, man, God just began to fill me with so much more truth, because I was able to change. Now, since that time, that was in 1994, that allowed me to look at other subjects, other things, at least look at them, whether I go on the bandwagon and say, "Well, I believe that now." But growth, maturity, and spiritual experiences demand change. I couldn't preach the things I preach now 35 years ago, Steve. I was too immature. I didn't have the knowledge. I didn't have the understanding. I didn't have the comprehension. Just like your mind, how much it has grown. You couldn't jump back 35 years ago and share the things you share. Now, why? God has increased your knowledge. He's anointed you and your knowledge to grow. So we were, for a better lack of terms, we were immature. So as we matured, God says, "Hey, I'm going to keep giving you more. I'm going to let you see more. You're going to grow more." And you are able to put it together. It's not just the fact to say, "Well, that's a white light. That's a black board." No, I understand why it's white. I understand why it's black. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right. Yeah, you understand like the thoughts behind it from God's perspective, because God's given you His perspective. And let's deal with the rapture, David, the specific quote-unquote proof text, and even the two will be in the field, you know. Let's share those. I think it's critical because, again, ladies and gentlemen, it's my position, it's our position, that until people understand, they're going to have to get prepared spiritually first to go through the most horrific time in the history of the world. If they think they're just going to get out of here at any moment, they're not going to be effective. The salt, in effect, has lost its savor, in my opinion, by doctrine, and also the light has gone out because I believe that that's a false doctrine. I have been in a meeting, I won't tell you where, but I've been in a meeting at a restaurant. I think, Tim, you may have eaten there, but the point is we got into an argument over the pre-tribulation rapture. And thank the Lord, David, I was restrained, okay? And so was the other gentleman. And basically, it was over the rapture. He said, "What kind of a God would make..." This is a very prominent Christian, okay? And what kind of a God would make my daughters suffer through the tribulation? And my answer to him was, the same God that would take them through it, okay?
Yes.
And I've had people, another, he's gone, so I won't mention names of somebody's dead, but a guy told me, you know, if there is no rapture, I'm done with this Christianity.
Yeah.
I've heard that. I mean, I'm not making that up. These aren't proof texts or proof illustrations. Go ahead. Share where they get it, because there's one guy on TV, we won't name him. He's got seven raptures.
Oh, yeah. Let me just simplify this. There's only one first base and a baseball diamond. So you only got one coming, and you got a second coming. You can't have seven phases to the first base.
Right.
You know, if you hit the ball and don't get there in time, you get thrown out, you're just out. There's just no, you know, change there. The wicked have always been removed. Solomon, I think it's in Proverbs 10. He said, the righteous shall never be removed from the earth. Who inherits the earth?
The meek.
The meek. Okay, let's go back to Noah's day. Was Noah raptured? Who did God remove? The wicked. Was Lot raptured? Who did God remove? The wicked. Both men stayed on the earth, but God took the wicked away. Even when Christ returns, Paul said his brightness will destroy the Antichrist. He's coming to destroy the wicked and set up an earthly kingdom, and we're going to rule and reign with him as kings and priests. So I know that's a feel good, but it's a false theology. The Great Tribulation, let me help you understand something. All these pre-trib guys are so wrong, and I'm going to tell you why. The Great Tribulation is not the wrath of God.
Amen.
The Great Tribulation is the wrath of Satan. Revelation 12:12, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you and I, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Now, you'll look in Revelation 12, he's always going from the earth to heaven, falsely accusing you and I. By the way, in Revelation 12, if the church is already in heaven, why is he up there accusing us? We've already made it. It's because we're not there. So he's continuing to accuse us because Jesus has not come yet. So Michael, Revelation 12 and 7 says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. So war starts in heaven, and it starts at the throne room of God, and God kicks Satan out, his angels, and I just saw this the other day. He is confined now to the earth. I was reading that again the other day. I never caught that before. Hmm. God confines him. He can't even do it. He can't go nowhere else. He is now confined to the earth.
Has to live within the total hell he created.
That's exactly right. And that's why he's mad. Great wrath. He's going to vent everything he has, because it's like a dog in a dog lock. He's going to tear up Jack. He's going to dig holes. And you go in there, he's going to tear you up. He's mad because he understands, I can't get out. Now I'm doomed.
Well, plus all the other fallen angels see that, hey, he isn't God. Because, you know, that he deceived them.
This is why it's utter chaos.
Yes.
And this is why, unless Christ would return, he said they're going to destroy the whole earth. Satan would take the earth as we know it now back to Genesis 1, without form and void and darkness. This is where we would go, folks. But Christ will intercede. He will come back. So the Great Tribulation is nothing but the wrath of Satan. The wrath of God is distinctly a separated part. Revelation 15:1, Revelation 16:1, the seven vials, they are bowls. In them is filled up the wrath of God. Take a bowl and like that, and it's all out. Take a bottle and it takes a long time. That's why he puts it in bowls. And so this is the wrath of God, and he's going to do this so quick. Now, we've all been subject to Satan's wrath. Job was subjected to Satan's wrath. I mean, his children, his wealth, then his physical body boils from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. That's great tribulation if you don't know.
And not a great woman.
Oh, no. Well, it's bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh says, why don't you curse God and die? He said, and of course, God got the blame. He said, the Lord hath given, the Lord hath taken away. I'm not going to say he's actually blaming him, but God allowed it to be taken away. God didn't take it, but he allowed it to happen, because in Job 2 and 6, he tells Satan, he said, Job is in your hands, but don't take his life. That's a terrible place to be, in the hands of Satan. So now we know scripturally, I'm giving you Bible, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 and 10 says, for God hath not appointed us unto wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him eternally. So if you're alive when he comes, or you're dead when he comes, you have been secured from this wrath of God. As you said, he's going to deliver us through the great tribulation. Those which are alive and remain. We hear that quoted 1 Thessalonians 4, 16, 17. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall be raised first. This is just protocol. The dead in Christ shall be raised first. Then we which are alive and remain, the word remain there in the Greek means those that have survived the great tribulation, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort ye one another with these words. Hmm. Now, when Christ returns, he's only coming back with one people, the dead. 1 Thessalonians 4:14 says, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. It's only the dead in Christ that he brings. And then that's why their dead bodies are raised first, because they're going to be reunited. And then we which are alive remain are going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. What we're going to do, we're going to come right back here to the earth at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and he's going to take over. So I would encourage you, if you're struggling with this false doctrine of the pre-tribulation rapture, my book I wrote, The Second Coming, A Second Look, I have 7 questions in the back of the book. If you answer those questions honestly, there's no way there's such a thing as a pre-trib rapture.
They're proof texts, okay? To them, the rapture is the blessed hope, okay? Yeah. But that's not, I mean, you just gave the whole thing. Matthew 25, immediately after the tribulation of those days, shall they see the Son of Man coming. But the proof texts, run through those, because again, this is night and day. You know this. Every major television evangelist is on this, with the exception probably of Jim Baker, because he doesn't believe in pre-tribulation rapture. But even some of the biggest ones, their whole fight now is to take on guys like us who are saying, wait, you're not biblically accurate, you know? Whether it's, I don't even want to name names, but the point being, you know, the idea is that's, can I say this? That is more important to them than Jesus.
Oh, absolutely.
So use the proof text they use and tell where they're wrong, because you know, the most famous ones, 2 in the field, 1 will be taken, you know?
Well, I even heard one, and I'm going to refrain from calling names today, but he quoted 1 Thessalonians 4, 16, 17, 18. That's the rapture of the church, proving that it's pre-trib. That scripture text tells you nothing about timing. Mm-hmm. It tells you the protocol of how it takes place.
Right.
And so they're twisting that to say something that it does not say. They go as far as twisting 2 Thessalonians 2 and 3, where Paul said, let no man, here again, this is men trying to deceive people. Paul said, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, what day? Verse 1, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together unto him. That day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. They say the falling away should have been translated rapture. The falling away in the Greek is apostasia. It means to defect, to depart from the faith, and a bill of divorcement.
Apostasy is that's the spinoff of apostasia.
Exactly. So I thought we were gathering together under Christ and not divorcing him. And then if you go on through that whole passage, it speaks directly of the Antichrist. Paul is telling them the protocol. You're going to see the Antichrist in the temple. And then he says in verse 6, there, 2 Thessalonians 2, 6, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. Why is he saying that? Paul says, number one, I'm going to be dead and gone. Some of you may be dead and gone. But when you see the Antichrist sitting in the temple, declaring himself to be God, you remember I told you this is how it's going to take place, how it's going to happen. And so this thing with Donald Trump, the pre-tribulationists are getting more boxed in a corner than ever before.
Amen.
Now that the embassy from Tel Aviv can be moved, they said it may take 3 years, from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, we're saying to the world, we recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. There again, why does Satan gonna suffer, pressure the Antichrist to set up in the temple? He's going to say, I'm God.
Amen.
You and I are going to see this. CNN, ABC, NBC, Fox, their cameras are gonna be there in Jerusalem, and this guy's gonna say, I'm God. And the world's gonna freak out, especially the Christians. We're gonna say, oh, this is like Peter on the day of Pentecost. This is that which is spoken by Joel the prophet. We're gonna say, this is what Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 2. This is what John said in Revelation chapter 11. Here it is, the temple in Revelation 11. The witnesses are there. They're gonna be prophesying against this evil work. So it's all in the scripture.
Right, right, and even a really important point, the moment Antichrist is revealed, whether the two witnesses are alive on the planet right now, they are revealed at the same time. And, you know, I mean, seriously, David, over the years I've been on talk radio, when there was email, I probably have everybody, every other guy is one of the two witnesses, you know? Yeah. And then when I ask them, I said, well, I know one of them, you know, and they'll say, well, who is he? I said, well, see, you're not the second witness, you know too. No, that's a true story. But the point is that the idea is simply this, that the pre-rapture doctrine has brought spiritual impotence into the body. It has caused apathy. It has caused almost an egalitarian or an egotistical, well, that's just for you peons. I got to share this with you guys, the film crew and everybody that's listening to this. You know, I actually got a guy saying, well, I can see you're going to be here during the tribulation. He says, I'm going to be up in heaven when I'm raptured. I'm just going to be laughing at you. I said, brother, with an attitude like that, I don't think we have to worry about seeing each other.
Steve, one of the terrible things that's oftentimes said is this. I know we're getting close to the close here. The Lord could come any minute. That is hogwash. A woman, once she conceives, cannot have a baby any minute. My wife was almost 5.5 months before she began to show that she was pregnant with Terica, our first child. I mean, because, you know, she's tall and slim and she just didn't look pregnant, but she was. But the fullness of time has to come for that child to be born if it's going to live outside of the womb.
Amen.
And so it is with Christ. Christ cannot come any time. He came the first time, and he was born in such a way in the fall of the year that he would be 33.5 years old and come around to spring and fulfill Passover in the spring of the year, literally. He told the disciples at the Last Supper, he said, with desire, I have desired this Passover. He had attended 33 of them. He knew what Passover was, but he said, this one's about me. I came to fulfill it. So when he comes the second time, he's going to come in the fall of the year. I can assure you, it'll be the fall of the year, September, October. I don't know what year, but it will be in the fall of the year, fulfilling two feasts, Feast of Trumpets, Feast of Tabernacles. The trumpet sounds, and then Revelation 21:3 says, God himself shall tabernacle with men. Just like the first coming, Feast of Passover, Feast of Pentecost. Those happened at his first coming. God is a very synchronous, divine God, and things happen according to his time. Psalms 31:15, David said, my times are in your hand. If it's a good time, a bad time, a time to get married, a time to have children, a time to change jobs, all our time is in God's hand. Jesus Christ was born at a certain time, Paul said in Galatians 4:4, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. That time was made pertinent 4,000 years before it happened.
Amen.
So that 4,000 year time came, the son, Jesus Christ came into the world.
That might be a good thing to do another episode on, especially the difference between the general time and the specific time.
Exactly.
The chronos and the kairos. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're hoping to give you an accelerated degree in understanding the Word of God, because it is going to play out before your eyes and your children's eyes and your grandchildren's eyes, and you need to know the truth, because the truth will set you free, but it'll also keep you free.
Amen.
Amen.